Cashflow Diary Podcast, episode 58.
Congratulations, you showed up. Give yourself a high five in celebration of your success. Welcome to the Cashflow Diary, where new and experienced investors come to take confident action towards their goals. Your host is a family man, a real estate entrepreneur, investor, coach, and instructor. As a master facilitator of Robert Kiyosaki's Cashflow 101 game, he's inspired many to begin their journey into creating cash flow for themselves and their family. And now, here he is to offer you the tools required to earn the income desired. Your cash flow coach, Jay Massey.
Congratulations, you've made it to yet another episode of the Cashflow Diary Podcast. I am Jay Massey, your host. Very excited to be here today because we're going to talk about, well, cash flow and real estate. You knew that already. And more importantly, if you've paid attention, sometimes, you know, we go through life, we do things, we say, you know, I want to stick with the status quo. I'll do what mom and dad says to do, go to school, get good grades, get a job, and life will be okay. I think you're going to enjoy the story that you hear today. I think you're going to find new ways to look at the place where you might be or the place that you're headed in a unique way. Because our special guest today has a lot to share about that. Now, if you're joining us for the first time, welcome. Make sure you go over to learninvestingnow.com, learninvestingnow.com. Claim your free real estate education course right this moment. And for those of you who have been with us for a little minute, or maybe this is your first time and you're going, you know what? I'm done learning. I'm ready to start earning. Great. You go over to begininvestingnow.com because that's where we help you be able to literally begin investing by providing cash flow, investor ready rentals for your own choosing. Make sure that you go there and we'll let you know when we have more available. Now, here's the point. At some point in your life, all of our lives, yes, we have to learn, we have to have that technical skill, but we have to figure out how we're going to also take that and make a difference. Today's guest has been able to make a difference in many, many different arenas. And that's what's amazing is that once we begin to understand and look at and occasionally let go of some of the things that we think are accurate and let ourselves grow, we then become this completely new thing that's very exciting. And what's exciting to me is that there are so many people, so many entrepreneurs, so many hardworking individuals that we can find to bring to you so that you can be introduced to them too, so that you can understand that everybody's got a story and we can get started together. Now, what I want you to do is that I want you today, I want you to put down the dishes. I want you to stay focused on what we're sharing today, because I know that today's information will be able to not only make you feel smarter, but make your wallet bigger too. So do me a favor and welcome Mr. David Phelps. David, are you there?
Hi, Jay. I sure am. Thanks for having me on today.
Excellent. I'm glad that you are joining us all the way from the great state of Texas. That's how I'm supposed to say it, right? Great state.
The great state of Texas. I certainly will back that. Yes, sir.
That's the only way it can be introduced. No other way to introduce it, I'm sure. Now, for those who may not be familiar with you, would you do me a favor? Tell us a little bit of your, what I call, I ask everybody, you know, to share with us your origin story. How did you get started? What motivated you to begin to delve into business and to real estate?
That's a really good question. In fact, Jay, I had to some years ago actually go back and really figure out where that came from, because I grew up in a great middle class family, great parents who both had careers. Neither one were what I would call entrepreneurs, just hardworking business owners. And I don't know where my actual entrepreneurial spirit came from, but I knew looking back that I was doing a lot of things at a young age that were a little bit outside the norm in terms of learning how to earn money and selling cards, stationery, door to door. I was always doing things just to try to do, I was a little bit different, I guess, from that standpoint. But I took a traditional path, that being, you know, getting the best education I could, trying to get good grades, get scholarships, and go on through college and then on to what became my profession, that is dentistry. So I went through dental school, and that was a great road, a great path to take. But at the same time, there was still this entrepreneurial side to me. And while I was still in college, one of my last couple years of college and still getting through the requisites to go on to dental school, besides reading the physics and the chemistry and the biology courses that I had to take, I was started thinking ahead a little bit, you know, how am I going to be a good steward of the gifts that God's given me? That is, you know, to go on and serve people through dentistry. How am I going to be a good steward of the income and put that to good use? Meaning, how do I invest my money? Mm-hmm. And I read books on the stock market, and I read some books at that time on real estate. Now, this is back in the late 70s, so there wasn't the internet, and there wasn't, books were where I was at. But there were some good books out there, and when I compared and contrasted the stock market to real estate, there was, hands down, real estate made total sense. The stock market just did not to me. I just couldn't understand, you know, how I could have any control over the stock market. And so, long story short, while I was in my first year in dental school, meaning I still had another 4 years to go before I would graduate, I talked to my dad, again, who had only owned the houses we lived in. He was not a real estate guy. But I said, Dad, I said, look, I'm going to be here in Dallas, Texas for 4 years paying rent in an apartment. What say you that we consider going together? This is kind of talking about joint ventures, even though I didn't understand what joint venture was back then. I said, Dad, if you would come down here to Dallas, we'll go out, we'll scope out some neighborhoods and look for what could be a good investment property. And so he did. We spent a couple weekends doing that. He lives in a couple states away from me, so he made the trip. He believed in me, and he put up the credit and the financing so that we could together acquire a property. I was obviously the managing partner, co-venture partner in this joint venture. I managed. I learned what it took to manage the property. And 4 years later, when I graduated from school, we sold the property and made a nice profit, a nice capital gain. And when I looked at that, and I thought, you know, I went through school, college and dental school, and I waited tables at night and on the weekends. And my half of the profit on the sale of that one property was more than all those nights and weekends I spent, you know, earning money, trading time for dollars, which was not a waste of time. But I'm just saying, I thought, you know what, there's something here about real estate that really has me going. So I went on, graduated dental school. We sold, as I said, we sold that one property. But while I was still building my practice and starting in private practice, I started looking more at real estate and what next properties I could acquire. So I started acquiring more properties. I mostly single family, duplex, a fourplex, but mostly single family. And it just started to build from there. And I'll tell you, Jay, you know, I made plenty of mistakes, plenty of mistakes. But the good thing about real estate is because I kept my deals relatively small and I learned how to structure the financing right and be safe about it, none of those mistakes ever came back and took me down. In fact, I will say to this day that since I'm not really a speculator, I'm not really a property flipper, I'm more of a long-term buy and hold person, that none of the properties have I ever really lost any money on. Everything has worked out. Real estate really is very kind to those who are on the investment side. Not taken away from those who are more on the business side, but that's just the way I looked at it. So that's my story of origin, how I got into real estate.
Awesome. There are so many things that were in there, but one of the things that I want to pull out for everyone to hear, did you hear how the younger years actually trained him to identify opportunity? That's what was happening when he, you know, you're out there, you know, you're knocking, selling stationery door to door. You're learning how to identify opportunity. And you then just took that one step further, and you identified an opportunity. Hey, Dad, instead of me, you know, spending all this money on rent, here's an opportunity for you to earn some money and me to get some experience and all this other stuff and for us to work together. That's what happened, and it was cool when you can learn to train yourself to recognize opportunity, and you did it. One of the things that you also mentioned, though, that I would love to hear more on, because you talked about how all those nights working didn't add up to the same amount of money that you were able to earn from that one property sale. There's a concept that I often talk about is return on time. That's one of the things that I personally love about real estate is my return on time goes much, much higher simply because, you know, you leverage so many other pieces and time is so much more valuable than the dollars that we have. And I love how you were talking about wanting to be a good steward, because just in the same way, and this is the question, in the same way that we always wonder, are we a good steward of our money? I think we should also be a good steward of our time.
Yes.
Yes. And so with that being the case, when you're comparing stocks versus real estate, how does that play out for you? There was some comparison, there was some decision, because there could be someone listening right now, because cash flow can be derived from at least dividend paying stocks. And you can use, you know, bonds in certain ways. There are other ways to use paper financial instruments to create cash flow. But what, in your opinion, makes real estate so much better that it's a no-brainer?
Jay, for me, it's because real estate is a tangible asset. It's an asset that I can have control over either through holding title or from a secured position as a lien holder. And the fact that I can have some of that control, I don't have to have all the control, but I can have some of the control. I can take that real estate and through adding value to it, whether that's, you know, through the improvements and also adding the management component, which again can be done by other people, but these are the value adds, that property will produce the cash flow, or as you said, the dividends, just like a stock will. But if that property is not producing what I feel like it should be producing, I've got some choices there that I don't think I have when we're talking about paper assets. I can make changes in the performance of that property by changing the tenant, the occupants. Maybe I need to change the actual structure, the desire of that property. And maybe if that property is in the wrong location, I just need to sell or exchange to another property. Lots of things I can do to have control. Whereas I feel like in the stock market, I don't have that same control. I'm putting my trust in somebody else who's going to manage. And that's okay if that's what someone's personality is, if you want to do it. But I've got to have some level of control. That's just always been me. And it's as you said, there's a return on time. So if somebody is really makes a lot of money doing what they do in their business or their profession, then maybe they shouldn't be so involved in the micromanaging of real estate. But as you said, you can empower other people, you can leverage other people who can put those things in place, and still you can have that control factor over the property, whether you're a title holder or if you're in a debt secured position as a bond holder would be in paper assets.
Yeah, exactly. And you know what I just find this interesting, how you and I have come to the same conclusion. And we get started at different times, but yet we still come to the same conclusion. And I find it interesting, and I'm sitting here thinking, are real estate guys just control freaks? Is that what it is? we want control, so therefore, you know, we want control. So we slant towards real estate. I think that's very, very interesting in a unique way. Now, you and I also have this slant towards, because, you know, there are many, as you call them, speculators, absolutely. And as everyone who listens knows, there's three values on any asset. You got your use value, which is typically retail. Then you have your speculative value, and that's the fix and flippers, wholesalers. And then you've got your investment value, the same people who would buy dividend paying stocks are probably akin to being okay to purchase the properties for rental. So my question is what, how did you decide to make the decision that buy and hold and producing cash flow versus capital gains was like where it was at?
Well, for me, I could use my career, my profession in dentistry to provide for me the cash flow that I really needed for my lifestyle, whatever that was. You know, everyone has to decide what lifestyle do you feel like is adequate, sufficient for what you do. The lower you can keep that lifestyle, obviously, the better while you're in your growing years. So I didn't really need the cash flow to add to my lifestyle, and it didn't make sense to take extra cash flow and then just have to pay tax on it. So I much preferred to have the value of that investment property, my equity, actually just be there and let it compound, let the growth compound through the normal forces that we have in the marketplace, that being inflation, appreciation, or the value add that we can do by, you know, renovating properties to a certain point, and also the opportunity that we have to leverage properly financed properties, and that being through the amortization or the pay down. That's the obviously the other way to build up equity. So by structuring the financing the right way, and I'll just say this real quickly, I'm not a big proponent of people using banks or institutional financing. I use private financing. I'll use seller financing. so many more creative ways you can do that. And that's where the real value for me was, because I looked at every property that I could acquire, or let's say even have some control over, because I can still have control from a debt position. So either in title as an equity owner or as a control in the debt finance structure, Jay, that I had the ability to build up capital gain. And that capital gain to me is like cash on demand. Cash on demand means so some way down the road, if I need to access the equity in that property, that I have the ability through the community of other investors that I know to actually take out that gain when I want to, or start cash flow from that equity when I want to, but not until then. To me, that's the real value, but it's something you really can't do with banks. Banks, there's a place for banks, and I've used banks, but I don't think in my portfolio they have a place. And if I can keep it within a private community, there's so much more flexibility and diversity that I have in managing my assets and making them work for me and keeping as low a tax profile as I feel like I can.
Oh my goodness. I cannot believe you just said that. It's just so amazing, because I'm sitting here going, did he just really say that? Because I feel the exact same way in so many reasons. But and I tell people who are concerned about taxes, it's because you don't understand the tax code. The tax code rewards people who do one of four things. So everyone listening, write this down. You do any one of these four things and you can totally control your taxes. You provide energy, you provide food, you provide jobs, and you provide housing. You do any one of those four things, and the government will gladly give you your tax money back. As a buy and hold real estate entrepreneur, you're providing housing and typically jobs as well. So you've got two of those four on your side, and you become a master of your AGI, or adjusted gross income, so that your tax issues tend to go away. And that's what that's one of the things I love about the whole thing. And I'm just sitting here beside myself, because I get the question all the time. So I'm going to ask you, I get this question all the time. And because they people ask me, Jay, why would you work with a person when you could just go over to the bank and get a better interest rate and all this other stuff? Why are you going through all this extra trouble? Why don't you just go to the bank? Would you say to that, David?
I get that question all the time too from some people that I consider fairly sophisticated. And it's a great question, because yes, we have historically all-time low interest rates right now in the marketplace, and they won't stay there forever. The reason I tell them not to use banks for their investment financing is because, number one, banks require full disclosure of all of your personal assets, your financial statement, your cash flow. You've got to bear everything to them. Now, I'm not saying that we're talking about hiding things, but the problem is also when you're dealing with a financial institution, there are issues of the application one makes. And I have known some people who, not because they got into trouble over deals they did, but there were other issues that maybe it was going through a partnership breakup or divorce or something. All those things are out there on the table, and there's even an opportunity, unfortunately, for the government through the HUD regulations to look at it once the application they put in for financing, that they did the best job they could, laying everything out on the table. Think about it. How difficult is it to miss something, not on purpose, but to omit some piece of information, and they can come back. I'm talking about the HUD and the government could come back and actually call someone on the line for fraud, because they left something out of an application. Very, very scary. And I just don't believe in doing that. Another reason I don't like to do it is because bank institution loans are full recourse. So not only are you getting financing on that particular property, but you're opening the door so that they could come back and attach any one of your other properties should something happen. And again, we're not talking here, Jay, to people today that are unknowing investors. I mean, I think everybody who's a part of your program are astute, and they're studying and learning, but we don't have control over everything in the economy today, do we? I mean, there's a lot of things that we don't have control. And if something causes a property or cash flow to stumble, do you want to let just that one property stand and take the fall, or do you want all of your assets to be on the line? I pick the former. I don't want everything to be on the line. The other reason I don't like to use bank financing is simply because, and I'm sorry, I lost my train of thought. There was one more great reason why I don't like to use it. Those are some of the keys. Maybe the other one will come to me, but that's the reason I don't like to do it. And lastly, the banks aren't really a good partner. You know, when I can deal with private lenders, and this is what people don't like to do, because as you said, it's harder. It's more difficult to build relationships. It's easier to walk into a bank and say, I've got a great credit score,
right,
and I can produce the financial statements, and the bank says, great. You know, today we're opening the spigot a little bit more. We're making those kind of loans. So great, you go get it. Well, that bank or that banker is probably not going to be there in a year or 18 months. Things are changing so fast in that marketplace. So that relationship you thought you had, you've got to start all over again. You've got to prove yourself up every time to the whims of the marketplace and the whims of what the feds are doing to the banks, because the feds really control the banks. Now, when you're talking about real people, potential private lenders, in which there's a lot of money sitting on the sidelines today from people that hold that money, and they want to get it into good investments outside the stock market. They'd love to be involved in real estate. Those can be your lifetime friends, and you don't need a whole lot of those people. I've got several people that are within my environment, you know, other professional practice owners, doctors, who have provided me significant amounts of money to go into deals that I do. And you know, we have the opportunity to change and modify those deals as we wish. It's so much more flexibility, and I can go back to those people time and time again because they're always looking for more good deals.
Oh, yes. Yeah, I feel like I'm at church right now and you're preaching to the choir, but because it's so and for me personally, one, yes, my origin story dictated that I had to go this route, but at the same time, I know that I would have preferred to go this route. And I think eventually, and here's something that I think many people miss, even those, especially those who have a professional practice, et cetera, or a high, you know, a good small business going, I think they miss the fact that at some point, even if the banks stayed the same, the banks are eventually going to cut them off. You're limited in the amount of access that they'll give you.
You are, Jay, and that reminded me what the third and final point on the bank loans is. Take a note that you signed recently or in the past and read all the fine print. Now there may be a term. There may be a term of 15 or 20 year amortization, and there may be a call provision at 3 or 5 years on a commercial investor note. But dig into that and read the fine print. Realize that in every note that's being written today, and probably in the last at least half a dozen years, there's language in the note that gives the bank the right, the legal right, to call that note on demand anytime they feel like either their collateral or you as the borrower puts them in any kind of jeopardy.
Yeah.
Think about that. So so what I'm saying is you may be paying your note just fine. Everything's good. But maybe they see the real estate market as being a little bit shaky. That's enough reason for them to come in and say, you know what, we're going to call the note. Sorry, you've been a good customer. You've been making your payments fine, but we're going to call the note. Or if you go through, as I said earlier, maybe some kind of a partnership breakup, maybe you're unfortunately going through a divorce, and the banker hears of that, that could give them the reason that they'd like to call your note. Now, many times in this environment, it's because the feds are requiring the banks to keep a higher ratio of capital to liabilities, and they just need reasons to call notes due so they can bring capital back in. I've seen that happen to people in my profession on their commercial office buildings. For no fault of their own, they get a note called. So I just, again, that's my big warning and what I've seen in the marketplace.
Yeah, I love this. This is so great because, you know, there are just inherent risks. When it's easy, there's probably a reason. And, you know, the extra work on the front end, at least for me, has paid off in dividends, because there's so many times. And you know what? What's really funny for me, David, is that if I'm going to have to, you know, pay interest or share a deal, because that's really what it comes down to, if I'm sharing some of the profits of the deal, whether it's characterized as interest or, you know, you're getting cash flow or what have you, I would rather give it to a person who has the ability to say thank you. I've not ever gotten a thank you from a bank. What about you?
Well, I think they owe me a few thank you cards because I haven't received anything either.
Right.
But you're exactly right. Well, it's just so much more fun. And I say that wholeheartedly. It's more fun to do deals with other people because they need us. I'm talking about people who don't have the ability, the time to go learn and do the due diligence and put deals together. Knowing how to find, first of all, and put together through the opportunities we see through our own eyes. That's a skill.
Mm-hmm.
It's a skill that takes time and experience. There's a lot of value in that. So and then structuring and negotiating, closing that deal. So you bring a deal to the table, and then now you're going to possibly manage that deal as well. There's huge value in that, and there's plenty of people out there that would love to be part of your deal. I'm talking about anybody who's listening to this call, your deal, because you've got a track record and they believe in you and you've created that relationship. We're helping real people this way. And I think too many of us, Jay, think in terms of, well, you know, I need money to fund my investment deal. And I think we're looking at it the wrong way. I'm trying to turn this conversation around and say, look at the value you bring. I think it's an opportunity for someone who has money that need to get invested. It's an opportunity for them to be part of your deal, not vice versa. It's how we present ourselves that makes a lot of the difference in whether or not we're successful in bringing that money into our investment portfolio or not.
You know, you remind me of something that I often say in a lot of my live events, but I don't think I've ever said to the individuals here is, understand that there is more money than there is experience in the marketplace, and money seeks the to be used, and that's why it's currency. It's got to move. It's got to go somewhere to do something, and it's seeking more. It's seeking more of itself, as you know. And when you have that limited quantity, there's a limited amount of experience. This is what David is sharing with you right now, is that there's a limited amount of experience, and if you have that experience and you have that ability, time, and knowledge, then yeah, there are lots of individuals, more than you would think, you know, and you know many of them right now. That's what's amazing about understanding what it takes to put together the system to be able to structure, negotiate, and close deals, as has been mentioned. And I think, you know, I'm curious to get your perspective. I think we're the rare bird out there is the one who has the ability to actually put these deals together, but more importantly, not only do you have the ability to put these deals together, but we're willing to work with individuals, because most of the people that I know that put deals together, they still want to work with banks, thus cutting out the opportunity for the other person. I think you and I are the rare ones. What would you say?
Okay, yes, I stopped it right there. At some point, we're going to run a competition just to see who can guess when I'm going to stop it and come and talk to you. Anyway, Here's a couple of things. As you can tell, we're talking about one of my favorite subjects already. And I love the approach. I love the fact that there are many people doing it all across the country. As many of you know, we've been running a Raising Private Capital Mastermind group, and we've had some new people join us already, which is great because it's not too late to get started. And that's what they decided to do. They're like, man, it's time to figure out how to go out there and make things happen. And it's exciting. But speaking of raising private capital, this is one of the things. As you already know, we're not doing a cash flow question until the book is out. The book is coming soon. I was talking to the publisher, producer today, and getting all the final details on crop marks and covers. And there's just so much that if you've never written a book or published a book or gotten a book out, you those of you who have, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Anyway, one of the major topics covered in the book, and for those of you wondering what book, it's my book. It's called Cashflow Diary. It's a diary of how we've been able to start with relatively little, nothing. As many of you already know, you know, my wife and I started a number of years ago. We had, she has hyperemesis, which meant she could not walk and talk. I had a punctured lung, I couldn't walk and talk. She could not eat or drink. And together, that's how we started, with a credit score of 398 and couldn't put $75 together, squatting in bank-owned property. And we've been able to build a real estate portfolio, and we put it in a book. The steps necessary, literally steps necessary to, for lack of a better way of putting it, take the phoenix and rise from the ashes. For you, one of those things that's in the book is how to raise capital in the very unique tool that I call the Profit Analysis Quadrant. That's one of the major tools that we use inside of our Raising Private Capital Mastermind group, and we've been going through it, and people have been able to get in front of hundreds of thousands of dollars, and it's been amazing watching them go through this process as they learn it, which is, again, in the book. For those of you listening, okay, this is one of the things that I wanted to say. I've been talking about get the book. And so now I'm going to give you something extra. If you've already pre-ordered the book, you already got this. So don't stress. You know, the digital advanced reading copies, yes, they are available. So you get those immediately with the pre-order. You also will get a video training for the Profit Analysis Quadrant, which is the tool that I've used. I think to date I've raised well over $7.5 million using it. And it's worked well for me and my wife, and I think it'll work well for you, and it's a video that'll teach you how to use it along with the book. Anyway, if you want to get that pre-order, you can still do so. cashflowdiary.com/book, cashflowdiary.com/book, or send a text message to 949-682-3565. The text message should have the word book. So send book to 949-682-3565, and it'll be on your way to you. Now, let's get back to the interview.
You're right. We are the anomaly, and that's that. You know, I'm trying to break that mold as well, because I know so many people in my, you know, just my local geographic area in the Dallas-Fort Worth area who are, they're really good, hardworking, what I call boots on the ground entrepreneurs. They're out there finding those deals, and then they need a little help either in structuring and closing, and they need the opportunity to find the capital. You know, I can bring capital a certain amount of their deals, but I want to teach them how to do it themselves. And it's sometimes, again, just having the conversation with them to explain to them and show them where their value really is, and all the hard work they're doing on the front end to identify and structure the good deals. There is so much value there. But too many, again, it's because it's what they were taught. It's kind of the environment. It's the mindset that I think pervades the marketplaces. That is, well, just go to the bank, you know, because the rates are low. And, you know, but as you said, even if you can get those loans, it's limited access. And then we talked about the other issues as well. As soon as you stop using the banks, the opportunities will actually explode, meaning they'll grow larger. Because the whole mentality behind how you have to use a bank and structure everything to fit their particular criteria, mm-hmm. I think limits. And I can, you know, when I look at a deal, you know, I always figure out at least three different ways it can be structured, mm-hmm. and it just makes it so much fun to be the orchestrator. Because now when you're not limiting yourself to just a bank and you're looking at all the other people, I've got a whole list, a whole document where I have different potential private lenders for whom I know what their needs are, what amount of money they have, whether it's in IRA accounts or it's outside the qualified program, their plans, what kind of money they have, what their goals are. I have a whole list of those, and so now it's just a matter of plugging those people in to the deal that makes sense, and that's where it becomes so much fun.
Totally, I love this because this is entrepreneurship at the grassroots level, where you're still dealing with the people, the persons, and you're helping in so many ways. And we create so much value on both ends of the spectrum. You get to provide clean, safe, affordable housing. You're providing the jobs. And now on the other side of the business, you've got individuals who may otherwise choose something as like a certificate of deposit. And now they have another option. And those are the things that I think you're doing that are great, because you're changing, and I'm not trying to be overly dramatic, but you are affecting and changing lives and possibly generations depending on how the deals are structured. And I get a lot of personal satisfaction from that. What about you?
Absolutely. I think we're filling a void in the marketplace, and that's what entrepreneurs do, Jay, is the marketplace is always changing. You know, the more volatility, the more chaos, really the more opportunity is out there. And so think about it. You know, we're kind of on this, we're on the upswing from the, you know, quote unquote last recession that, you know, hit us in 2007, 2008. We're on this upswing, but, you know, amidst all that, there's all been all this turbulence and chaos. And today in the affordable housing arena, it's still very difficult for would-be, wannabe homeowners to purchase property. It's very difficult for them to get that financing. And so there's a great need for affordable housing, either for good tenants, or if one's in the mode where they can offer seller financing to do that, and bring in that private capital, because the private capital is looking for a place to go. So we're filling that void because they don't want to be in the stock market, too much volatility. They can't be in CDs or T-bills very long because the interest return is so low there. They know that inflation's going to eat that up. So we're putting all these pieces together, as you very well said, and helping so many people, filling that void that the conventional, I call it conventional or traditional marketplace, cannot fill.
Indeed, indeed. But David, you keep telling them all of our secrets, man. Man, now they're going to go, oh, that's what they're doing. Yes, that's what we're doing. And that's what we're encouraging you to do. That's the whole point. We want you to go out there and develop your own streams of cash flow. It does take specific energy, specific time, specific knowledge. So because of that, I've got to ask you a question. You went through all of this, you know, schooling. You went through all of this training to practice dentistry. But yet, that's not what I'm hearing you go, you know, all excited about right now. So what happened? How did you even get to the point to where you go, you know what? Maybe I need to make a change.
Well, yeah, let me take you back on that. Dentistry was, and still is to this day, I don't practice anymore, but I mean, dentistry was a great profession and it opened a lot of doors for me. Had I just stayed focused just on dentistry, however, I don't believe I would have had the opportunity to deviate or leave the profession when I needed to. And here's what happened. It was 10 years ago. It was actually in 2004. My only child, a daughter, Jenna, was just diagnosed with end-stage liver failure. And the reason that occurred was because when she was much, much younger, at age 2.5, she was diagnosed with acute lymphocytic leukemia, high risk, and went through 2.5 years of just awful chemotherapy. It was just a very, very difficult time, obviously, in her life and in our lives. She got through that. Then she had bouts with epilepsy and took a lot of medication to try to control the epilepsy. So all the drugs, the chemotherapy, the drugs for epilepsy, overtook her liver. Her liver could not process anymore because the liver is what detoxifies everything. And so her liver was shot at age 12. She was actually vomiting blood because her liver was backing up. Very, very scary time. I'll just fast forward and tell you that Jenna is 21 years old and a beautiful young lady, and she's doing well post-transplant. She's had ups and downs, so I won't hold that back from your listeners. You know, that's the good news. Mm-hmm. Having her healthy is the most important thing in my life. But here's the epiphany I had, Jay, back then in 2004. So Jenna has the transplant. She's in and out of the hospital for the next 18 months. This was not easy. She had a lot of complications. They had to go back and open up ducts that were closed down. I mean, it was really, really hard. That period in my life is when I gave myself permission. And I'm going to say that again. I gave myself permission to change the way I was running my life, because I was built on this concept that, yes, as you said, I went to school and I got all this training and got a license and a degree to go practice dentistry. And I'd done that up to that point for about 20 years and done it very well. I had a good practice. But I was able to easily at that time take that hat off of dentistry and say, where do I need to put my time? And it was with my daughter, with my family. Because even though I was really successful in doing the things that I did in dentistry and real estate, the regretful part of my life is that when Jenna was diagnosed with leukemia when she was 2.5 years old, I was so busy being this guy trying to build this security for his family that I wasn't even present there. And that still hurts to this day. That still stings. Now, the good news is Jenna's still with us. I totally changed the way I run my life. And I pulled myself out of my practice, made my practice really a more entrepreneurial business, which, again, is something I never thought I could do. But I had this great reason why. I had a reason why to do things that I always thought about doing. But now I had the reason why to go do it is about my daughter. And the point I'm making here that I want your listeners to think about is that you can make the changes in your life wherever you are right now if you have a strong enough reason why. As long as we stay in that kind of that box that we call our comfort zone, which means, you know, we can get by, we're paying the bills, but, you know, we're not really living our life. We're still waiting for that someday when we'll have it all together. That someday, I'm telling you, friends, for most people, it doesn't come. Someday does not come. If you're not doing things and making change and transformation in your life right now, and it doesn't happen all at once. You've got to take steps, but you've got to be around smart people, people that bring wisdom from other areas, and that's what I started to do. You know, being with you on the calls that you do, Jay, you bring so much value to the people. You've got to hang around with people like that, and that's what gives you the strength to persevere on and push through those barriers, because we all have them. They're all in front of us every day. But trying to run and play solo in your life, I don't care how smart you are, how hard you work, that is not going to get it done.
No, not at all. I love how you said the two specific things. You gave yourself permission and that you had a really good reason why. You had a reason why. Oftentimes I found, at least in the individuals that I work with, the same thing that you're calling a reason why becomes the very reason why they say they can't do something. You know, mm-hmm. You could have easily have said, my daughter's not well. I don't have time for this. I can't add this to my plate. But yet that is not the decision you made. And because of that decision you made, you now enjoy the things that other people want. And you get to reap the benefits of that decision for decades to come. And I commend you for being able to make that decision. I also find it interesting that it was, the impairment of a loved one medically that also got you to make that decision, because that was very similar for me. You know, my wife developed hyperemesis while pregnant, and that meant she couldn't eat or drink. And then I punctured my lung trying to play volleyball because I was trying to blow off steam because I was so stressed out. And now I couldn't walk and talk without fainting. And we were quite the pair. And we had to figure out a way to do something different, because what we were doing clearly wasn't working. And that gave us the reason why, not the excuse. I love how you were able to create a decision and then follow it through. Now, I'm curious, what advice would you have? Because I know I run into a number of small business owners, those that do professional practices. A lot of the investors, yes, they're doctors, they're attorneys, they're all kinds of individuals in various, you know, genres of business. What would you say to that person? Because occasionally I get the question from them that, you know, they think the best way for them to attack real estate is for them to do all the work and do the deal themselves. What would you say in that case?
Yeah, that's a great question, Jay. Let me just use an example. I have a good friend who is a dermatologist, does very well in his practice, but he started investing with me, gosh, probably some 4 or 5 years ago, and we got started and we've done different kinds of deals together. And we had this very conversation maybe a month ago. We were having dinner, and he said to me, he said, Dave, he said, could you set me up so that I could kind of start doing some of these deals myself? And I looked at him across the table and smiled, because we're good friends. I smiled and I looked at him. I said, Mike, why? I get it. So here's the thing is people think that they're giving too much away. And you said at the very top of our call today, it's you know, how do you leverage your time? Well, in this case, his best use of time is when he's putting that time in his practice. He can still, even in this environment today, makes a good income there. He's trying to move, to replace that income through good real estate. And I said, Mike, let me just take you through a few of the pieces that are involved every time that you invest in a deal with me. And I started walking him through. And I said, I've got people, on my staff, my payroll, that handle all these pieces. And I walked through, I took a deal we'd done. I said, let me show you all the things we do. And then even after we closed that deal, I said, the management after that, it requires this, this, this. I said, he's got three daughters that he loves to spend time with. I said, here's the problem. I said, if you start trying to build this on your own while you're still in practice, now that time that you're spending with your daughters, guess what you're going to be doing? You're going to be running off meeting contractors, dealing with tenants, evictions. I said, it's going to tear you up because I did it that way. And I know better today. I didn't know differently back then. No one showed me what you and I are talking about. I learned it through the school of hard knocks.
Right.
But it's my imperative today to not let other people get involved to that level when it's not their time. Now, I said, when you're transitioning out of your practice, you're kind of going towards that retirement phase. And I said, if you like this stuff, great, then we will jump in and I'll show you exactly how to do all this. And if you like that, go for it, but not right now.
Totally. I agree with you thousands of percent. Some of my investors are up in Hollywood and, on shows and whatnot. And I tell them all the time, I'm like, look, I want you to keep making quality entertainment because there's not enough of that right now. You focus on making quality entertainment. You let me and my staff do what we do, and everybody's going to be happy because I think that, wealth is a team sport. And that means, you could do it, quote unquote, all yourself, but it takes a number of of failures, a number of mistakes, a number of attempts before you get it smooth and you have a staff and it's systematic in any sort of way. And that's time, that's valuable. And anytime you can leverage to gain that knowledge, to gain that access, I think you earn an even higher return than you otherwise would have, because now you don't take as much risk of not being able to actually produce a return. Because I was taught, first you protect the money, then you go for a return.
Yes.
And right. I find so many times that, you know, a new investor comes to me and say, hey, look at the deal I did. And then in about 30 seconds or less, I can point out one or two things that I'm like, you didn't protect the money. We got to start there first, because they're always focused on, but this one pays X percent return. It's so much better. And I'm like, yeah, no, let me tell you why. And then they begin to understand the amount of due diligence and work goes into just property selection, let alone how to manage them and how to rehab them and how to make them produce a return. So I often think, and I'm curious to hear your perspective, I think many people come from the aspect, because oftentimes, you know, the marketing could be guilty of making it sound like all you got to do is just buy the real estate and everything else is handled. The property itself produces the return. What would you say to that?
Well, you're absolutely correct, Jay. That is marketing. That's a message. And there is so much that we know, you know, behind the scenes in making all that happen. It's something that you learn through experience. You learn with good mentors. I say that, you know, we should focus, you know, first on our strengths. You know, everybody talks about, you know, working on your weaknesses. We all have weaknesses. And I think rather than focusing on weaknesses and trying to make those better, focus on your strengths, and you can bring other people, you know, within your wheelhouse or your system or your structure that can complement those. But there's so much that goes on in the due diligence and selecting and acquiring and structuring and negotiating, closing a deal, and then the management thereafter that really makes it produce that the message out there today makes it look like it's very, very simple. And that's, again, why we both agree that there's so much value to those who are orchestrating, putting deals together. And I think we tend to put that aside and think, well, the money coming in, the capital that comes to bankroll these investments is the most important part. It's important, mm-hmm. but it's not the most important part. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, I break down the, you know, every transaction to four basic parts. And, you know, that is the, you know, finding the deal, you know, find the deal, which means you know what the opportunities are, and then you can structure it and put the deal together and close it. And then third on my list is, you know, the capital to actually fund the acquisition. Finally, is the management. You know, there's kind of four parts there. And I'm not saying they each have a 25% factor, but right. it depends. Every deal depends. It depends. And that's what you build with your investors. When you show them the things that you're doing that they can't do, or it would take them a long time to learn, then they start to appreciate the value you bring. Then it's when you're going to really have that relationship with someone who really starts to appreciate it. I mean, let them ride around with you for a day or a weekend, or look over your shoulder if that's what it takes to appreciate all that you've done. And they'll quickly decide, okay, I don't need to be building this right now. I see what you do, and I'm really appreciative of the opportunity to be able to invest the money in some of your very good deals.
Yeah, yes. Well said. I can hear you've had some of the same conversations that
Absolutely.
I've had too. I find that interesting. Well, as we're getting towards the end here, if someone out there wanted to find out a little bit more about you and how you're able to work with, you know, professional practice owners and in your area of the world, what would you recommend they do? What would be their next step?
Probably the easiest way, Jay, would be for them to go to the website www.freedomfounders.com. That's founders with an S.com. And there's more information about, you know, what I do and really my passion for helping professional practice owners, doctors, dentists, attorneys. We do have some attorneys that come, but I help them, you know, connect the dots with those who have the deals. And so I do some masterminds that are, you know, limited attendance, and I try to put the right people there. But go to that website. I also have a book coming out in about another 4 weeks. And that book also will probably speak a lot to people who are, you know, trying to figure this component out. You know, how do I speak to people who have money they want to invest? How do I kind of structure the deals? Kind of the conversation we're having today. I just put it in print to kind of give people a blueprint. And I'd be glad, you know, to be able to share, you know, at least that much with people who are more interested in what I do.
Excellent. And before we close, I want to know, when it comes down, what would you say to that person? Maybe they're listening for the first time, or maybe what I think more people are guilty of, listening many, many, many times, but yet they haven't taken any sort of action. And, you know, they see maybe retirement approaching. They see their business has got a stranglehold on their time and they can't actually extricate themselves anyway. They don't have an exit strategy, or they're just looking at what can I do to earn more money? What would you say to that person right now if you had that one shot to suggest what they should do and how they should be thinking?
Information is great. Information is out there everywhere today on the internet, in books, in CDs and DVDs and webinars. Everywhere you want to go, the information is there. The problem, Jay, is that there's so much information, people get confused. And a confused mind usually does nothing. I think the best way to get the right information, right for whoever that person is, because everybody's in a unique position in life, a unique place, and has unique resources and assets to put into what they're trying to do. To get through the breaking points, to take the information that's most relevant to where each one of us is, I think you've got to be a part of a community of some kind. Now, a community could be a local group that meets, that talks about investing. A great community is your cash flow community. Someplace where you can meet and be amongst other like-minded people, because it's being around other people that are also sharing the same successes, but also the same setbacks, because we all deal with those. And you've got to be around people that keep encouraging you, and then you can get the right information. There's always going to be people in a good community that shares and collaborates, that have, you know, the connection to the resource, connection to the idea, the action plan that you specifically need to break through wherever your current challenge is. There's no cookie cutter. So that's my point. You've got to be part of some group that you really relate to, that you feel like is, that speaks to you, that has people that are like you, but can help you, keep you accountable and help you move through that comfort zone to the areas that can help transform your life, your business, those things that you want to be doing now and not waiting for that someday down the road.
Indeed. Well, I want to definitely thank you for your time today and just for sharing all of your wisdom and experience, because you know, I know there's just so much more that you do have to share. And for those of you listening, go over to freedomfoundersws.com and be able to make sure that you follow up with David, because I'm sure he's got additional information that could help you as well. This has been yet another episode of the Cashflow Diary podcast. I am excited. Hopefully you've been enjoying each and every person. As you can tell, we all create cash flow in various different ways. Some of us do it with real estate. Others of us do it with a business. Some people combine the two. And there are so many ways to skin this cat and play this game. Each one of you have a shot. And now what it's time to do, it's time to take immediate massive action and move at the speed of instruction. So for now, I look forward to talking to all of you guys one more time again soon. Until next time.
Thank you for investing your time with Jay Massey and the Cash Flow Diary. When you have a moment, please visit iTunes and leave a positive comment about the show. And go now to our website, cashflowdiary.com, to take advantage of our free business building course, Cash Flow Foundation. Gain the knowledge, understanding, and skill that will teach you how to never need a job again. Until next time.
Until next time. Until next time.